fighting that deep in a lot of things. A lot of times, just hang around.
Okay. Good morning, everyone.
Hey,
it's all turn my little here. It's on. You would turn your phones on silent, please. Let me wait for you to. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. Called over this planning commission meeting. Mr. Slay, would you mind doing an invocation?
So good and so kind and merciful and gracious toward us, Lord. We acknowledge your presence here with us today. We thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for the wisdom and the discernment that you give to us freely. When we ask, Father, we are asking now that you give us wisdom to make good and wise decisions. I pray, Father, that as we conduct this business today, it be pleasing to you. Father, that we'll leave out of here today with a renewed commitment to serve our fellow man even better than we have been. Father, I pray that our citizens will recognize the freedoms that they enjoy. Father, not only that, the privilege that it is to participate in our government. And Father, that is a privilege that we don't want to take for granted. Thank you for our first responders and for the military personnel who protect us. Please keep them safe in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Consideration approval of minutes.
So move.
Second.
Motion, Mr. Morrow. Second. Gaines. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, old business.
Okay, under old business, we're going to review hearings scheduled for Monday, December the 5th. The first item is a conditional use permit for Jackson Refrigeration at 653 Highway 469 North. This property is located on the west side of Highway 469. Kenneth Jackson of Jackson Refrigeration is seeking the conditional use permit to replace an existing building on this property with a 3,200 square foot metal building. Mr. Jackson uses the building for storage of parts and tools used in his refrigeration business. It's a 2.67 acre parcel. It's zoned RE1A. You can see the existing building in this aerial photo. This is an existing shed that's going to be torn down. This is his site plan. He shows the location of the building. He's going to add a new fence along the back and the side to buffer that area. This also shows the elevations of the building. This is a view of that property and the building that will be replaced. And these are surrounding properties.
You hadn't had anything on that, have you? You hadn't had any?
That property has been posted, and the notice was published in the paper, but we've not received any.
You're not, calls. I don't think you have. It's going to be such an improvement and everything. That'd be good.
Okay, the next item is a conditional use permit for Petra Jenkins at 249 Bragg Street. Bragg is off of the west side of 471. This property is at the very end of Bragg Street. She's seeking the conditional use permit to place a manufactured home on this 39-acre parcel of family land. It's zoned R1B. This is an aerial view of that property. There are three other homes on this property. She's currently looking at a 2014 28 by 76 manufactured home. This is a view of the entrance to her property. This is where the manufactured home will be placed. And these are surrounding properties. The property was posted, and the notice of the hearing was published in the paper, and we've not received any calls on this either. Next is a conditional use permit for Sheila Harris at 136 Gilbert Circle. Gilbert Circle's off of Luckney Road on the east side. Ms. Harris is seeking the conditional use permit to replace an existing manufactured home with a 2017 32 by 80 manufactured home. This is an aerial view of the property. You can see the existing mobile home on that property. It's a 1 acre parcel. It's zoned RE1A. This is her site plan. And the manufactured home has already been placed on the property. This is a view of that property and the manufactured home. And these are surrounding properties.
It's already moved in?
They've hooked
it's
utilities.
She doesn't have utilities yet, but it's already there. They, it was there when she came in. They had already moved it. It came from a dealer in Hattiesburg, and I called and talked with him and made him aware that we have an ordinance that prohibits that. Sent him a copy of it, and he said it wouldn't happen again. But we, you know, will impose that double permit fee.
Okay.
These are surrounding properties. That property was posted and the notice published, and we've not gotten any calls. Next is a conditional use permit for Community Place on Lake Vista Place.
Yeah, he called me.
They're seeking a conditional use permit to construct a 60-bed skilled nursing home. Lake Vista's off of Spillway Road. It's a 7.07-acre parcel, zone C2. It's in the Spillway Road Commercial Complex. This is an aerial view of that property. And this is a view of that property. They're buying three lots. They were previously granted a certificate of need by the State Department of Health for a site in Pearl. They ran into some problems with wetlands, and they couldn't afford to mitigate that property. They plan to file an amended certificate of need for this new site on Lake Vista Place, but before doing so, they need to be able to inform the State Department of Health that the Board of Supervisors has granted the conditional use permit for this location. They're in the process of retaining an architect and engineering firm to develop their the proposed nursing home and the site plan. They don't have any of that yet. They understand they will have to come back for the site plan architectural review before, you know, if they're approved. This is a view of to the east. This is to the west. And this is back to the north. This is on the corner of Spillway Road and Lake Vista. This is the Freds, and that's the MEA. They had some conceptual drawings that they submitted with the application. They said that the nursing home will be very similar to these drawings or these renderings. That property's been posted and the notice published, but we've not received any calls on it either. The next item is a conditional use permit for Kelly Foster at 491 Mount Helm Road. This property is on the north side of Mount Helm. Mr. Foster is seeking the conditional use permit to place a 2007 16x80 manufactured home on this property. The red box is an approximate location. It's a 130.62-acre parcel. It's zoned RE1. It's currently being used as a dirt pit. He wants to place the home on the property for an employee to live in and keep an eye on the property. I think he has plans in the future to possibly develop a subdivision on an adjoining parcel. And he's saying that the mobile home will only be there for a temporary period until that subdivision is built out and established.
So it's going in the dirt pit?
Yes, sir, on that property. It's going to be placed approximately where those vehicles are parked. And then these are adjoining properties.
All the neighbors may get upset.
We, yeah. We did say we'd put some restrictive language in there. And when I met with him, this was in conjunction with developing a subdivision. Is, I mean, you mentioned a little bit, but in at some time he might plan to build. Does he say that now it's not?
No,
imminent?
I assume he is going to.
Should we put a time? I mean, if he never, well, I don't. I guess if we're that.
One of the things I think you're going to want to do, Steve, is when you approve the placement of this particular home, you're going to put a time frame on that.
Let's,
you know, 2 years. Whatever y'all
would. Well, it'd probably be a little longer than that.
Well, how about if we did something like if they at such time they quit using the dirt pit and or start developing it?
Well, he wants the trailer there for somebody to manage the development more than the dirt pit is what I understood.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
yeah.
I would say more of a 4 year, 5 year, maybe 4 years or something like that. But
well, really, what's it going to hurt up in a sand pit?
I just don't want to make this a presence where we start and we have another
Trailer
park
yeah.
down the road from where there's one already.
Or not only that, every dirt pit won't put a trailer in.
Or five.
Yeah, a real trailer.
Okay, well, we posted the property there, and the notice was published, and no calls have been received.
Okay.
Last item is a conditional use permit for Robert McIntyre on Mount Helm Road. This property is on the north side of Mount Helm. He's seeking the conditional use permit to place a 2014 double-wide manufactured home on a 6.60-acre parcel. It's zoned RE1. This is family property. The red box, again, is just an approximate location of where it'll be placed. This is his site plan. We posted this property and published the notice. We did receive one call. Originally, Mr. McIntyre was going to enter the property from McCoy Lane, which is a private drive. The call said that he didn't have an easement or access to that to come down McCoy Lane. And so he submitted a new site plan, and he shows his driveway coming in off of Mount Hill now.
Is this some of the same real estate that he was wanting to do the alternate dirt pit?
I don't think so. This is his, Robert McIntyre's son, Robert Stacy McIntyre, wants to put the mobile home there, and I think his father lives here in this house. Yeah, it says Robert McIntyre. But I don't think that's the property. I'm not sure, but I didn't think it was.
Something you want to check on?
I really wish it was, but no, it's okay.
Okay, this is a view of an approximate location of where it'll be placed on that property. And these are the surrounding properties on McCoy. And then these are homes on Mount Helm.
Okay, any considerations?
I'm just curious, have you got any complaints about that?
Oh, no, sir, I'm sorry. Right. We posted it and published the notice, but we've not gotten any calls other than that one.
We got a clean slate, no complaints on these. Yeah. They move fast Monday.
Yeah. You jinxed it now. Yeah. The room will be full come Monday. Said the room will be full on Monday.
It'll be full, but it's not going to be that.
It's going to be full.
It's going to be full, trust me.
Really?
Yep.
Not on anything.
Oh.
Good silence.
All right.
good capital.
Good. Yeah. All right. Go ahead.
Okay, under new considerations, the first item is a conditional use permit for Danette Hunt Tillman at 1585 Monterey Road. This property is located on the north side of Monterey. She's seeking the conditional use permit to operate a tax preparation and bookkeeping service in a new home that her mother, Patricia Hunt, is building on this property. Mrs. Hunt has had an accounting and tax service in operation in Vicksburg at her home for over 20 years. She's wanting to relocate her home and business to Monterey Road to be closer to her family. That's an aerial view of the property. She says that most of her business is conducted by mail and electronic means, but she does have a number of clients who prefer to come and deal with them face-to-face. This is a two-acre parcel. It's zoned A1. This is a site plan showing the home. And then it's just a one-room office shown here. This is a view of that property, and these are surrounding properties.
I make a motion to set the public hearing.
So, second.
Motion to set the public hearing by myself, second Mr. Morrow. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
Okay, the next item is a rezoning request by S&S Builders of Mississippi, Inc. on Highway 468. This property is located on the west side of Highway 468. Scott May of S&S Builders is requesting to rezone this 44.24-acre parcel from RE1A to R1. It's part of the old Diamond Fields development. Mr. May plans to construct a residential subdivision. He's calling Ironwood Estates. R1 requires a minimum lot size of 11,500 square feet. This is an aerial view of that property. This is his preliminary plat. It shows 43 lots with an average lot size of 26,480 square feet. The sewer is to be serviced by the city of Brandon, and they have Greenfield water. This is a view of that property. And then these are surrounding properties.
Renee, is this the same one that we had to go around with about the 1 acre lots and everybody gets so upset?
They were smaller than that, the last go around.
The original submission from the original developer was 300 plus lots. Mm-hmm. A second submission came from a secondary developer who was looking at developing it, and it was 103.
Yeah, but that, this same property that Swain bought, but he's now sold it.
Yeah, the first one, I think, is the one who filed suit.
Yeah, the first one filed suit against the board. Okay.
Right.
Glenn Hanley was involved.
And so are we going to get the same backlash for the 43 now?
No, not this side.
You may get some feedback, but it won't stop me from moving forward with it.
Okay.
I make a motion to set the hearing.
Second. Motion to set the public hearing for tomorrow. Second, Mr. Gaines. Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
Okay, the last item under new considerations is a conditional use permit for Morgan Stone at 1837 Highway 471. This property is located on the west side of Highway 471. Ellen Morgan of Morgan Stone is seeking the conditional use permit to expand the existing stone yard at that location. She plans to construct a 1,200 square foot office building on her existing 3 acre lot. This is the existing 3 acre lot. They have a temporary office building that they're using now. She wants to replace it with the 1,200 square foot building. She also purchased this 1.7 acre parcel that adjoins it. Currently, there are two rental manufactured homes on it. She plans to remove those manufactured homes from the property and expand the stone yard into that area. This is a view of her site plan. And this is the front elevation of that building. This is a color rendering of what that entrance will look like. This is the side elevation. Floor plan. And then this is a view of that property. And this is the area where she wants to expand to.
They already own this now, don't they?
They've purchased this lot. Mm-hmm. That property is zoned R1. And the Morgans are here if you have any questions for them.
I'll make a motion to set that public hearing.
Second.
Motion to set the public hearing, Mr. Cross, second, Mr. Gaines. Any discussion?
I would like to commend those two. I've known them a long time, and I remember when Mr. Morgan had a truck and a trailer, and he put the rocks around pens, fish over here at Brandon about 20 years ago. He started a little rock yard. And he's got the nicest and biggest rock yard in Mississippi. And he wants more. He wants to build a building to make his front look better from the site and just enhance our county.
Yeah.
That is somebody that started from zero and has grown to be the biggest rock yard and best in Mississippi.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brad.
I had a motion and a second, and I believe Mr. Gaines is looking for some stone. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Well, thank you for what you're doing. Okay, let's see. We don't have any site plan architecture review. All right, next meeting will be.
Motion to adjourn to the 29th.
Right.
Recess, whichever.
Yeah.
If I say one, this it's going to be the
off.
Other.
It's a little off here. The next meeting held. That's kind of off, isn't it? Anyway, have a motion to recess.
Second.
Most recessed by Mr. Bishop, I believe it was, second Mr. Morrow. Any discussion? All favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Okay. Next, we move on into our Board of Supervisors meeting. And we'll call it to order at this time. And we have no public comment. We got Mike Harrison next.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I got approval for a utility permit from AT&T. Construct fiber along the route of Shiloh Road and Mandy Drive and John Shiloh Road.
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve, Mr. Bishop.
Second.
Second, Mr. Morrow. Any discussion? All favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
Got approval for a utility permit from Center Point Energy to have their pipeline inspector Lake Superior Consultants by drilling half-inch holes in road on the pipeline crossings throughout the county. And they're going to go in there and seal those holes back as they drill them.
So moved.
Second.
Motion approved, Mr. Morrow. Second, Mr. Gaines. Any discussion? All favor say aye. All opposed. All right. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Next, we have Attorney Craig Slay.
Drill holes in our
Good
morning, gentlemen. First item under my section is a brief presentation of the draft updated Rankin County comp plan by our friends at Central Mississippi Planning and Development District. As you know, the county undertakes an update of both its comprehensive plan and its zoning ordinance on a regular cycle. Typically, we like to do that every 5 years. We like to look at it and decide whether or not we want to update from there. Generally speaking, we do take advantage of the opportunity to update when we get that opportunity. And so we're here today to talk about a proposed update to our comp plan. I believe, Dave, correct me if I'm wrong, I think our last update was around 2010. Correct. Is that correct? Yes. All right, so it's time. We're 6 years hence now, and so it's time for us to look at it. And so Dave Wade, Gray Oots, I believe Chuck's here with CMPDD. They're going to demonstrate for you their work product up to this point. It is still in draft form, but I've had a chance to go through it and look at it. I'm very impressed with what I see. So I'd encourage you, we're going to try to keep it brief, but Dave's going to be able to use this screen here to walk through what it looks like.
Janice, did you hear that? Janice, I think
I
should do something.
Okay.
If it's okay, I'm going to present this from here so I can look at the computer and kind of walk you through this. And I realize we're on somewhat of a time frame, so I'm going to try not to take up too much of your time. And I also realize that y'all have not had a chance to read this or go through it. You do have a printed copy in front of you there. And as Craig mentioned, this is an update to the 2010 comprehensive plan. We looked at all of the development with the help of Renee and her staff. We were able to obtain building permits for the years since the last land use existing land use survey, and do some analysis of what had been done since the last plan. Now, as I mentioned, you have a printed version of the plan that we're very proud of. I think there's a lot of information in there. You'll see the same information in what we're calling story map format. This is an online version that once it is approved and adopted, I would think you'd want to have this on your website, on the county's website. We first used this a little over a year ago when we updated the Town of Pillahatchie plan. And the reason I mention that is since September of 2015, when it was adopted, I checked on it yesterday and it's been viewed over 2,500 times. Actually, it was 26 something. And I think that's a far cry from what you used to see when plans were adopted and they sat on the shelf at City Hall or here at the courthouse. People just didn't see it unless they had a reason to go to view, if they were a developer, attorney, or whatnot. I think this is a better way to engage the public, engage developers, hopefully use it as economic development tool even to showcase your county and what all you have to offer. As you go through both the printed plan as well as the online version, you'll see pictures from around the county where we're trying to not only include a lot of good information, a lot of good data, and the plan, but we're also trying to showcase the county to let the guy that's maybe five states over realize what you have to offer and why Rankin County has consistently past, I think, three decades, been one of the top four most populated counties in the state, and has also experienced the highest, one of the highest growth rates, usually in the top 3 to 5. That data is included in the plan as well. Where we're at there, that's just letting you know that this is actually your map viewer that's been developed over the past few months is integrated into this plan, this online version. So when we, when you're going through the online version and you need to look at things such as the proposed land use plan, the zoning layer, whatever it may be, it's included in this online version. And I think most of you are familiar with the map viewer, so I won't you know, talk about that too much, but it is in there. It's a lot of good information, a lot of good layers. But going through the online version, I think you'll just find this is a very interactive way to view the plan. You get the same information and data that you get in the printed plan, but I think it'll be a very helpful thing and a good way to showcase the county. At this point, I think when we get to community facilities and economic development, or not community, but the public input rather, and economic development, Greg had a couple of things to mention in that section.
So as you know, we did the public survey online using SurveyMonkey. We had 863 completed responses. We go through it in detail. I'm not going to bore you with those today. All of it is listed in the appendix of the printed document and the online version. We ask questions about where you reside in the county, incorporated, unincorporated, work commute patterns, shopping, where do you shop within the county or outside of the county, use of medical services, recreation facilities, and then areas of concern. Now moving on to the next section, it's the population projections. Again, a lot of data here, a couple of highlights. Since 1970, Rankin County was the 12th most populated county in the state. In 1990, it moved up to fourth, and it has remained the fourth most populated county in the state since then. As Dave mentioned, it is in the top five of rate of growth every year. And this is just a visual on projections as well, showing you that Farmington Station area from 2003 to 2015 and the development that occurred. We are projecting the population to continue to grow. The rate of growth itself will slow slightly, but you will continue. We're projecting in 2040 about 213,000 residents in the county. So then we get into economic development. This is a new element of a comprehensive plan that we have previously not included. Here, again, using it more of a marketing tool as well as a functional document, we wanted to highlight some of the things that the county has. So we looked at labor force, commute patterns, existing business inventory, housing, taxes, and land. Compiled national data on business, on the top sectors of businesses within the county. Those are business service sector, professional services, retail, construction, and medical are your top five business sectors. And then employment is retail, business services, finance, medical, and government, not including education. But just gives you a general breakdown, something that can be presented if somebody's interested in the county. This is a great way for them to access this data quickly and easily. And we moved into housing. We looked at the data that we were provided on building permits and used the MLS service for the Central Mississippi area, considered what projected housing needs are, what the housing market has been doing within the county, seeing the rate of growth. One very interesting graphic that Dave is going to show in just a minute here. This is building permits in the county and where they were located for the past 5 years. So as we have all seen, there is growth throughout the county. In particular, there is growth right around the municipalities and PRV. And that just furthers the diversity of the county from a very rural area to a very urban area. And the necessity of protecting the rural and the urban from each other and land use and zoning and furthering that. We analyze square footage based on zone and year, where it was located in the county. So all of that's here. And then we go on into a brief discussion on property tax and moving finally into land. And we considered what is vacant land, vacant and available land in each proposed land use category, making sure that there is adequate designated lands for each category to hold that growth pattern. One of particular note is there appears to be a great deal of vacant undeveloped land in the agriculture category. We all recognize that's actually active farmland that needs to be protected. But that being said, there is still plenty of land, and we make sure that there is adequate land for additional growth within the more urban areas of the county. So that's all included in this. Again, a lot of detail in this section, not going into all of it for you. But this is more a tool that if somebody calls you interested in, you know, what's the labor statistics, you can point them to this comprehensive plan, tell them to go to the economic development section, and it'll be there.
All right. Of course, this plan has all the required elements as well, community facilities being a big one. The good thing about working with, someone like Rankin County is y'all have kept up with the community facilities needs. I mean, it shows in the plan, the new Chancery Court building, the 100-bed misdemeanor facility for the jail, that sort of thing. So we did address community facilities, including schools, met with Rankin County School District. Of course, they're in the middle of a study for facilities needs as well, so we tried to coordinate with them so we're not duplicating things. But they were very generous in meeting with us, sharing some information with us that we were able to include in the plan as far as projected enrollment, anticipated enrollment, and so on. Of course, we addressed the transportation plan again. In previous plans, I think we neglected to address the airport, for example. So we did. We met with JMAA, and Craig and I went over there and talked to them about what are their plans, what are their needs, and that type of thing. Very important that we have the largest regional airport in the state right here in Rankin County. So we talked to them. You'll see in the transportation element some viewers, a lot of data that comes from the MPO process. I know some of you that sit on the MPO board will be familiar with that. As far as projected traffic needs and projected road improvements. There are, again, some more traffic-related viewers. That's on the average annual daily traffic and so on. And then the land use plan. Greg mentioned one topic that's addressed in the land use plan pretty heavily, and that is the diversity of land use in Rankin County. You go from a very, some areas are very rural, farmlands, timber, whatnot, to very urbanized areas that function really like a city, but they're unincorporated Rankin County. Of course, I'm talking about the areas between Flowood and PRV properties and the reservoir. So there is that balance in Rankin County where you have highly urbanized areas that are highly developed, really function more like a city that demand different regulations, and we saw that through the adoption of the reservoir community district. And then you have very rural areas, and you'll remember in those only districts, we don't even allow subdivision developments. So there's a lot of discussion on that and why it's important for the county to continually address this and stay on top of land development zoning issues. In the land use plan, there's also mention of some changes we proposed. One of the more significant ones was the parcels M and N. And on this video, you can't really see it as well on this screen because of the large screen, but we did some conceptual development on parcels M and N, and that came from some meetings that Mr. Cross and I had with PRV folks and talked about rather than just showing that land is vacant or residential state, what could be done, some possibilities there. Again, without going into too much detail, I realize you guys need time to read this plan, kind of absorb some of it. I'm going to suggest, and also something I failed to mention, you know, we've talked to you about some zoning amendments that we've already presented, and that relates back to this plan. So I would suggest that maybe once you guys have time to read through this, look at it. We did email you some links to the online version. It can be in your email. And so if you would like to look through it on the online version as well as your printed copy, then I would suggest maybe sometime in the near future we could get together, have another work session where I would be able to answer any questions you may have, or we could talk about changes or amendments you'd like to see in the plan, and also we could discuss the proposed zoning amendments at that time.
You guys have any questions?
I have one question.
Yes, sir.
When you looked at the population growth from now till, I think y'all, it's 2040, it was continued growth. Did y'all work with the Superintendent of Education with when they did their projections? Was that coordinated or not? Because theirs did not reflect with
no,
yours.
I was glad you brought it up. I was being that same
theirs
thing.
Right. Even had negative growth in part of the county.
I'm saying we're not going to grow. We're
yes, they did not work with us on their projections. We did meet with them and try to, you know, talk about what work they're doing without you know, us duplicating the I can't remember the name of the firm they hired, but they, and I did notice that in some of their projections, like in Brandon, even Northwest School District, yeah. I think Florence, they even showed some enrollment projections going down, which was a bit of a surprise.
Well, the fastest, I mean, it's not by numbers, by statistics, the fastest growing school in Rankin County is Pisgah, and they showed it have a negative 3% growth in 15 years. And I just can't agree with that.
Yeah.
I mean, there's so much area out there to develop it. So I just wondered, how do you feel about that? Do you feel confident with your stats?
Yes. Okay. Yes, our population projections are based on what we've seen in the past and projecting that out in the future. And I think Ray mentioned we expect the rate of growth to drop a little.
Yeah.
I don't think we're going to sustain the rate we've seen in the past few years, but it may go down a little. We're still growing, and we still have plenty of room to grow. And with you know, good planning and zoning, I think we're doing it the right way.
I think a lot of times school districts looking at a more narrow range a population growth,
right.
Steve. They're looking at family age, family units of a younger age. So that would necessarily, they would exclude folks that move in that may be beyond normal childbearing years, 55, 60 years old. You'll get some
population. The new growth is not 60 years old.
Right.
The new growth is youth. I mean, young people.
Yep.
So
I'd say,
I don't know.
At least 30 year old.
I still don't, unless we're going to come up with some.
Craig's right, though. They are looking at certain age cohorts and what they expect and those age cohorts to grow. And I think people having fewer children maybe factors into that. I can't really speak for their projections. We have some of the same data given their past enrollment. You know, we could certainly project it out based on what we know. But again, you know, we were trying not to duplicate the things they were already doing, but we could certainly take a second look at that if you'd like to
see. If you're comfortable with your numbers, I am.
Again, I realize this is a lot of information to throw at you in 10 minutes, but I would just suggest that maybe after you've had a chance to kind of look through it, we could possibly get back together and answer any questions or, and again, you know, may have changes or amendments you'd like us to consider.
I like that. This looks great. I spent some time looking through it.
So. Any other questions? I see you went to a lot of trouble for this. This is very thorough. Yeah, appreciate it.
Very nice.
Any other questions?
Thank you, y'all.
Thank you.
Mr. President, we're ready to move on. The next item under my section is a discussion of the proposed updated Rankin County Development Ordinance. Ms. Alan Scott is here from Engineering Service, and I just want to hand it over to him. I wanted to remind you guys that I've lost track of time. I want to say that it was maybe September when we handed out the draft copy of the ordinance. I think that's about right. Is that right? So this is basically just revisiting the issue. If you've got any questions about what we put in front of you back in September, this would be a good opportunity to talk to Alan about that. Otherwise, really what we want to try to accomplish here is to get some feedback from you guys on moving forward now. When do we want to initiate discussions? To whom do we want to issue invitations, if anyone, to talk to you guys and or us, your professionals, about the proposal, gathering additional information, that type of thing. So this is the purpose of the discussion.
Thank you. Thank you. Just a little recap of, we started this process back in 2013, and what we did is took your existing residential subdivision ordinance that you have, and then we looked at most of the ordinances, municipal and county, in the Tri-County area. We looked at others around the state, and then we pulled others from around the southeast. So we started with a broad range of different things that different counties and cities were doing, from smaller communities to Atlanta, Georgia, to larger things. So that's kind of where we started the process in 2013. Went through several iterations of this draft ordinance. And so what I was going to do, just to take a few minutes, unless you have specific questions, I was just going to kind of outline where we think there the major differences are between what your current ordinance is and what this proposal talks about. A lot, it looks different in that the sections are different. A lot of, probably 75% of this is already in your ordinance. So it's not a lot of change. It just looks different. So people have to get used to how it's gone through and how the different sections are. But where there are some changes, there are some significant proposed changes. It starts with the application process. Right now, you have a preliminary development conference with a proposed developer. This ordinance proposes you would still have that, but there's a documentation, there's a form, there's notes. It is a more formal process, and it is a pre-application than an application. Let's just find out a little more. Let you find out a little more on the front end before the developer has spent a lot of money. What his intents are. What am I planning to do? And so that's more formal now under the proposal than what you currently have. One significant difference is the fee structure to the developer is significantly different than it is now under the new proposal. That it's based on not only the number of lots, there still is a maximum proposed, but it's more than it is now, more money than it is now. Based on the number of lots and the size of the development. There is in the proposal, more construction supervision is proposed than what you currently have. And again, that's a fee put on the developer. And that's based on linear foot of roadway within the development, linear foot of drainage, and a number of road crossings, which are the things where we've had issues in the past, that what we're doing now is basically proof rolling the roads and things like that and using the developer's engineer certification to be our guarantee, so to speak, that it was done according to plans and specifications. So there's a little more detail in this proposal from the county watching those things and the developer paying for that. Another big change is easements. Right now, where drainage goes across roadways, of course, you're maintaining, you're getting roadway easements. This proposal, it calls for off-roadway drainage easements to become an easement to the county, and detention and retention basins to have easements to the county. Homeowners associations could still maintain them, but it would give you the authority to go in and maintain them if they weren't maintaining them. And then there would be a charge for that.
Okay. There'd be a charge for it?
The proposed ordinance sets up
how there would be a charge to the homeowner associations or the property owners within the development if they're not maintaining the retention detention basins or right-of-ways, off-road right-of-way, right-of-way, easements that run cross-country. Another big difference in what you don't, today you don't have haul bond requirements, and this proposal does have haul bond. And so that is a developer that's moving a lot of dirt would at our pre-application conference would pick a route that, that you and county engineer would help select, and then he puts up a bond. And so if his construction operation tears a bunch of public roads up, there is a bond there for him to repair those roads. That is not in your current.
When you say he's moving a bunch of dirt, is there a certain number of loads or tons or?
There is, and we can, you know, that's something that can be decided on in the details. And certainly the intent, if somebody's moving, bringing in enough dirt for one house pad, then that would probably be exempt, would not be in here. It could be, that would be your guys' decision, but that would not be the intent. Somebody that's bringing in 8 or 10 dump truck loads of dirt. But somebody that's moving a million yards of dirt, half a million yards of dirt on a big project, then there's going to be hundreds, if not maybe thousands of trips back and forth. And of course, we have seen, and you guys have seen, that can affect some of the roadways. So again, the proposal has a bond proposed in there, where it's a calculation and it goes through and it shows on the front end. Here's what the bond would be for. And if the roads don't tear up, then he's just, the developer's just spent the price of the bond.
Alan, can I jump in?
Yeah.
Your current ordinance, by the way, addresses the same content. It just simply doesn't have a provision for a bond. There's no security. But your current ordinance actually has language in it that says, hey, if you tear up our roads in the process of making or putting your development online, we have the ability to come back and ask you to fix that. We just don't have any security or collateral at all. It's all on the developer just to do it. So the change is not as significant when you look at it that way, but introducing the bond requirement provides a little bit extra security for the county.
What about loggers? Does that include?
No, sir. It doesn't.
They say you're kind of singling out.
Subdivision related.
I would.
Yeah.
The north part of the county, our roads are tore up way more by loggers than they are dump trucks.
Right. Sure. We have a hauling permit that we use for logging.
How many times have we ever collected on that?
Oh,
zero.
Very infrequently. I think when we've had an opportunity, Jerry can testify to this, when we've had an opportunity to address a logging issue on the front end, we have good results. Mm-hmm. Because it's clear to everybody what's going on, and they're much more apt to police themselves when they know we're watching. But Mike, jump in here, but my assessment on the logging side of it is we have a hard enough time keeping up with the stuff we know we got to tend to, which is our stuff. It's really hard for us to police the logging aspect of it. You go up there and you run them down and you say, hey, you're not supposed to be on this road. If you're not watching them constantly, they're going to get off the chosen path.
What's the difference in that and the dump truck? They're going to do the same thing, aren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, we've got a road that Mike reworked, and within 90 days, maybe 120, it was brand new. The loggers tore it up. I mean, it's coming apart at the shoulders, and I want somebody to fix that road. It's not long, but they tore it up. It was brand new when they started rolling down.
But in that case, it's obvious they're the ones that did it, so that is a little different than some.
And of course, as frustrating as it is, and we, you know, you clearly point back to a particular entity that's caused the damage in some situations, but not always, as Jerry points out. The second thing is you come up against the reality that it's a public road, and so the loggers are going to assert, I've got just as much access to use that road as anybody else as long as I'm underweight.
Well, so my thing goes back to the dirt haulers. What's the difference?
Well, the difference here would be, just like maybe Craig mentioned too, in the loggers, you've got this pre-application conference on the front end of this hauling operation that we're talking about here. So they're going to be a lot more amenable to doing what on the front end. I guess, I'm assuming if you had that with the logging operation, it would be the same way, but...
On this road, we did. Met with them before, I mean, when they, before they started. And I still don't see the difference in having that conference on the front end with the logger, as same as if we're gonna do it to the dirt haulers, do it to the loggers.
Yeah, you're talking about putting a bond up for it?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how you can tax, I don't mean tax, but how you can challenge one side without challenging the other.
Yes, sir. I mean, yes, because it's tearing the road up regardless of whether they're hauling dirt or wood or timber.
We will look at that logging permit again. How about that?
Yes, sir.
The last major difference is that this ordinance requires the developer, upon completion of the development, to submit digital drawings that could be imported straight into your database system. So that instead of just paper copies that get filed, they'd also have to submit a CD where they've done a record drawing, XYZ coordinates, longitude, latitude, or state plane coordinate systems that then your mapping, the clerk's office over here could take those CDs and transport them straight into their database so that the lots and everything would show right up properly on your database system where they are in the world. And so that would be a requirement at the end of the construction process for them to submit that. Those are the major changes. Like I said, I can get into some more detail if you want to.
We got a lot of detail we need to get into.
But those would be the major changes in what you're doing now, what this proposal is.
Renee, do we currently have, I know some other counties, they do an amenities bond on a developer where after they get done with the development and there's still some little knickknacks, the houses that's not being taken care of. Do we see much of that here? People having problems with getting the developer, because I know there'll be builders come in and build, but somebody needs to hold their feet to the fire and make sure everybody gets what they're paying for.
Jay, in the past we have had an opportunity, Stonebridge being an example, where you fold some of the amenities under that letter of credit requirement. The bridge was included in that, the lake was included in that, the clubhouse was included in that. We approved a portion of the development out at Cedar, maybe, I'm drawing a blank, but it's District 3, I know that. Highway 468, Weaver,
Greenfield Station,
thank you, with the pool and clubhouse.
Yeah.
We folded that into a requirement under the letter of credit. That serves the same purpose as your amenity bond.
Yeah.
I would suggest that what we want to do is at the pre-application stage, when we know this is the plan, this is what we intend to develop, we'll go ahead and address it at that point. If we see amenities on the plan, like a clubhouse, like a recreational area, other amenities for the development that would be sort of common areas eventually.
Yeah.
Go ahead and address it there and point out to the developer, you're going to need to include the cost of construction and completion of that amenity in your analysis for the letter of credit.
Okay.
So both the streets and the amenities would be covered.
All right.
Yeah, I think we've gotten in the habit of calling that letter of credit at the end to be a surface asphalt bond or something like that. So that's generally the biggest number. But I think your current regulation and this one proposes, you really can roll anything into that.
Okay.
It doesn't have to just be surface asphalt. Anything that he's not complete, the developer hasn't completed, that you want him to complete, can be rolled into that calculation for determining that letter of credit. And again, it's that way now.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I think that would be something we would want definitely look at. You said that we were going up on our fees for per lot. What or how are we going to justify that to the developer? Why are we doing that?
The amount of time that we spend, your county engineer spends,
What do we charge now, Alan, for what is the current fee now?
Right now, for construction drawing review, it is $10 per lot, $750 maximum. The proposal, for preliminary plat, there's no fee. Preliminary plat, so when Buster's looking at that stuff, there's no, it's just whether his time is billed to the county, but the developer pays nothing for that. This proposal proposes $100 per lot, $500 maximum for the preliminary review. The construction drawing review currently is $10 per lot, $750 maximum. The proposal is $1,000 minimum, $3,000 maximum. That's just based on the amount of time we know that over the years that we've spent doing.
Is that kind of the standard now of where other cities and counties are doing, or is this?
It's more based on our time over the past 20 years of doing what it's taking.
Okay.
To do that. It was real numbers right. Pulled out of our timesheets. And
okay. Do you know what Madison County charges?
No, sir, I do not.
Right.
I probably have it. I don't know right now. We got all that.
That's what they're going to throw back. Is what
well, the, we're going to bring the Home Builders yeah. Association in and give them opportunity to work with us, and I'm sure they're going to ask these questions. So.
Sure.
It might be good.
I want to be able to have an answer.
They'll know the answer.
It'll be a good comparison.
Currently, you said that right now we're relying on the engineer of the developer to make sure the roads are put in correctly.
Correct.
And that's not changing.
You still require a certification by the developer's engineer. We would recommend you still require that, and this requires that, to certify or give an opinion of completion is what most of them are calling it now instead of a certification. But an opinion of completion that basically says, in the best of our knowledge and belief, the improvements of the XYZ subdivision were performed in substantial compliance with the plans and specs.
All right. If we want to, and I believe we do, want to have someone now to be there on site whenever they're putting in the drainage, how can we recoup our expense for that?
Okay, this proposal, your new proposal, has a table G in here that talks about that, and that would come after preliminary approval of a plat, construction drawings have been reviewed and approved, ready for construction now. Then there is a table here that based on, and I don't read all to you, but for example, a subdivision that had 501 to 1,000 linear feet of street, $1,000 observation fee. If it's got 1,000 to 2,500 linear feet of drainage, $800 observation fee. So based on what he's proposing, and our knowledge of knowing what it is we need to. We don't need to stand out there every second and watch everything, and so you don't need to pay for that. But there are times during that construction process where somebody, in our opinion, other than the developer or the developer's contractor, needs to be watching, especially cross drains, the places where you all guys yep. know where you've had problems.
I agree.
So there's a table that sets up, based on the size of the development, an observation fee. Now, your current rate, you don't have any of that. You don't have an observation fee. Somebody calls us, we go out, we proof roll, we see what we see when we're out there proof rolling. But if they've done all the cross drains prior to us ever being out there, then all we see is the proof roll. And the county pays us for our time on that. The developer doesn't pay anything for that.
That's where we need that checkoff list.
Yeah. Well, I really want us to have someone boots on the ground, not just make sure that the drainage is installed correctly, but the right drainage is being installed, not that they put the thinner wall, you know. And I know currently, are we changing also our materials that's capable of being used?
Right now, the proposal, yes, sir. Currently, no corrugated metal pipe is allowed in certain circumstances. The new proposal is no corrugated metal pipe. In fact, what's written in here right now is concrete only. Now, that's probably something as we move forward with this that we're going to, from an engineering standpoint, we're going to want to talk to you about, because we're certainly not saying that concrete is the only drainage material, drainage pipe material that is of quality. It probably is, on initial installation, the most foolproof. So we certainly would not recommend you take it out, but there may be some others we want to discuss getting in here.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, I think there's some other type, whatever we discuss, I don't know. It's not galvanized, but yeah.
No, there's lots of different types of pipe material now, and the plastics and the polymers and things have really gotten.
Yeah.
So there are some other materials that we would be okay with from an engineering standpoint. But right now, they're not in this proposal, only concrete.
So if we wanted to have an employee there at the time whenever they're making all their connections, do you think that amount of money is equivalent to cover our expenses?
Yes, sir. We can certainly look at that based on the time, but that's how we came up with that. Based on what we felt like, what points during the construction process does the county need to have somebody that's looking out after the county's interest? At what points do you need to have? Not daylight till dark every day, you don't need that, but at what point? So that's how we developed this. Here are the points that we think you need to have somebody there to see, and what's the cost associated with it. And of course, we were using consultant costs, so an employee might even be cheaper. So yes, sir, that's how we derived at this table to come up with these numbers to try to cover your costs. Oh, no, this, that's true.
You wouldn't need them all the time.
I think you need them all the time.
I'm saying.
Time during drainage.
Yeah, when they're installing the drainage.
Right.
Well, even this doesn't have somebody out there. Let's say a guy's putting out 1,000 foot of 24-inch concrete pipe, and it's going to take him 7 days.
Yeah.
This fee would not cover us, or probably even you having an employee out there, for 7 days. Daylight to dark for 7 straight days. This fee is not going to cover that if that's what you want. You might not really need that degree of, I mean, that would be great, but you might not need that degree of, for example, on crossings. We tell some of these guys now, put the pipe in, but don't backfill it till we come out there and look at it, or till you come out there and look at it. Well, it may take him, you know, 4 or 5 hours to dig the trench, put the bedding in, and lay that pipe in the ground. Well, you don't have to be paying somebody 5 hours to stand there watching do that. If he doesn't backfill it, then we can come out there, somebody can come out there and say, it's not done right, and say that in 30 minutes and drive off.
Right.
Or it's proper, it's done the way it's supposed to be done, now backfill it, and I'll stand here and watch you backfill it. 6 hours of contractor time turned into 1 hour of observation time. You got the same degree of observation.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know. This is new territory for me, so I don't know how long it's going to take us to have someone to monitor this, or how long it takes them to put in drainage, but I think it's something that we need to do.
My biggest concern, Jay, will be the learning curve, not only for us, but also for the developers. Once the new way of doing it is implemented, there will be undoubtedly occasions when a developer moves forward, contractor moves forward, he covers something up he shouldn't have, and the ordinance says, if you do that, you get to uncover it. You get to start over. And so there's those hard times when the reality of that extra cost to the contractor / developer comes rushing forward. We've got to be able to hold our ground and say that's the ordinance. It has to be enforced. We're looking out for the best interest of the citizens of the county. Eventually, the county's going to have responsibility for what you just did uncovered. We've got to be able to stand firm. So this proposal, I think, gives us the ability to do that, but we still have to have the the wherewithal to enforce that. So there's going to be a learning curve, and you know the realities, like I do, Jay. There, people are hurrying to get things done before weather impacts. And if you don't have somebody there who can go and inspect right then,
That's going to be a key.
That's an issue.
It'll be a big issue.
These guys are going to be screaming bloody murder, especially if we're all anticipating our growth in the near term to ramp up considerably.
Well, if we have one person dedicated to doing that, we should be...
Should be a kick cut out of cover.
Yeah.
Well, if you have one person dedicated to doing that, and he falls and breaks his arm, then you don't have anybody inspecting anything.
That's why we're going to go back to hire him to do it until he gets cast off.
These people are going to want to call you and say, tomorrow at 10 o'clock, I want somebody there.
Somebody's on a deer stand. Somebody's on a deer stand.
Yeah.
They may not be ready to, too, though.
No, I'm thinking that we're going to have an employee through our building department that can do this.
But you better have two cross-trained or something.
I guess.
You got one, it's going to be a headache.
Let's ask one question here. We're getting ready to put a whole heap of stuff on Ms. Renee over there as far as something she's not been accustomed to doing.
I think this should go...
He's going to initiate it, but I mean, still, I mean, she's going to be the front person on this thing for the county, you know. I mean, y'all going to catch the...
He's going to have a...
That's something we can work through that.
I think the majority of it would...
Work that out and figure that out.
Would come through.
I got an idea on that to start with.
Between Buster and Mike, they already involved with these people to a big degree, and I just don't think it would... I think it'd fit a lot better over there than over here. Not taking anything away from y'all, it's just they're already working with y'all.
But it's going to cost us a heap, a lot more money to pay an engineer to go out there and look at it than
an employee. Well, they don't have to be an engineer.
No.
And the amount of money you pay could be the same. I mean, we determine that.
Well, I think we have somebody on staff who's capable of doing that now.
Well, then put him over there under Mike and let him work with Buster.
Why do you say Mike, though?
They're already in bed with these guys, whatever.
They're already dealing with dirt. They're already dealing with...
They're out there.
But they're not in the... They don't... Mike's crew doesn't hit a subdivision until after it's complete.
Well, Buster's does, and Mike and Buster are together every day now.
I think is what Jerry said, and we work this out. We realize this is a big issue that we need to address that does need to be addressed.
We can work this out. I got some ideas.
And the intent of this table was whether you do this with consultants or you do this with one of your own employees, that ultimately the developer is paying for the cost of it, regardless of who you use to do it. That was kind of the intent. So we can tweak the table if you need it, tweak to the fees or whatever, but that was the intent, is for whoever's doing it, your costs are covered.
Hey, well, currently, whenever a developer comes in, we allow them to redo the drainage however they see fit.
No, we don't.
We don't?
No, they got to go through... Yeah, they have to be approved, the drain.
Yeah, they have to submit their plans and show on the plans what they're doing with respect to drainage in the development.
Yeah, we just don't say, you know, we'll go on whatever they decide.
But pretty much, they can go redirect. If there's a creek running through it, and they can decide to move it over here and redirect the channel.
It's not going to impede on something. Yeah, I mean, still,
well, they would still have to show no rise certificates, and, you know, they would still, your current order, like I said, this, the new ordinance doesn't really technically change a whole lot from what you're doing now. So under that scenario, Jay, they would, you know, they'd still have to come submit to Buster hydrology reports if they're going to move a creek. That would be a huge thing. If you're going to move a creek, they would have to do all kinds of things under your current ordinance.
Not a creek, but a major drainage area.
Major drainage.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Like,
same thing.
That goes through the middle of Oak Grove subdivision. And that one's near and dear to my heart because we got 8-foot culverts in there. I think at some point we need to draw a line and say, you ain't going to be burying these. It's going to be left open so that we don't have all these same problems we're having right now 20 years later.
Correct.
So,
to Jay's point, yesterday we met with a developer on a proposed development. His proposal is still preliminary, but his proposal established open ditch, no sidewalks. And on our side, we're both thumbs up, hallelujah, yes.
Thank goodness, yeah.
Because those are the areas where we have the biggest problems. So our attention about drainage is heightened. And I agree with Jay, if they're going to be burying large drainage structures, then we need to go very, very carefully. And my hope would be that we disincentivize developers from going that route.
Well, I think we're in a lot of trouble now in Daniel's area and some of his subdivisions. We're getting flooded with water because we've allowed them to move channels where we shouldn't have.
That's the wind, though. How long ago?
Jay, you did that 10 years ago.
Yeah, right. I mean, I was on the board, you know, but I think that maybe there ought to be a line somewhere we can draw where if it's a deep drainage area, that there needs to be an area where we say, no, we're not going to do it. It's going to follow the natural flow and you build around it.
There are some few differences, Jay, and here, you know, you have stormwater ordinance now. This ordinance gets a little more specific in the ordinance, but it doesn't really change from an engineering standpoint how the developer's engineer would attack that. And so, but you could get, I mean, you get as strict as you guys want to get on that. This is probably not as strict as what this is more basically the proposed is more what you're doing now. But you could get more strict with that if you wanted to.
We can take this and like you said, Jay, there's a lot to a fine print we need to work on. But this is really what you're presenting is a basic to mold off of what suits us.
Yes. Yes, sir. It is a draft. You look right at it and start, and I think that's what right. Craig said. This is really the point of where do we go from here.
But the drainage issue is the key focus of this whole
right.
baby right here, because the fees right. and all, at the end of the day, the developer ain't going to pay them anyway. They're just going to tack it on somebody else.
Right.
But this is the future that's going to end up coming back on us, which is right. the subdivisions we're talking about that we're just in a disaster with right now.
Right.
Correct. Yeah, that's
the future. Right.
The major differences here were proposed for what Mr. Cross just for those reasons. Where are you having problems? And we were trying to address right. where you have had problems in the past to try to make that easier for you to control in the future.
Well, this same thing would apply to a subdivision. It looks like what you see out at around Deer Valley. Yep. It's just massive erosion out there mm-hmm. now. Taking out fences. I mean, the same thing would apply there. And that's, gosh, that's an old, yeah. I mean, old neighborhood now, I guess you'd say.
It is.
So.
Because one thing for sure, if it's draining one way and they try to make it change, it's going to eventually try to go back the way it was originally.
Yep.
You know, so yes. that's.
Yeah. Mother Nature's pretty smart the way yeah. it routes water.
I would like for us to put something in there for that we are wanting to oversee the installation of our drainage, have someone on site, maybe not for every piece of it, but
a pretty strong checklist.
Yeah,
you know, spots.
And share this with our Home Builder Association so that we can get them involved with it, and so we can start negotiations with them on where they see we need to go.
Okay.
Yeah. Don't y'all think we yeah. need to get
they
those
need
guys.
To be involved, yeah.
Yes.
Wade Quinn's group.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I had got it. Yeah, that's on the agenda.
Bob can definitely be the one to chair that committee.
Chair what?
All in favor of Bob steering that committee?
What? Yeah.
Motion and a second. Bob steering that committee.
Yeah. All right. Look, I want to clarify.
Okay.
I'm not banging on dirt haulers.
Okay.
In fact, I'm more on the other side with the logging. The dirt people, most of them, live in this county. They buy their tags in this county. The dirt comes from this county. All the money is here in this county, whether it's spent or paid. On the other side of that, there's very few loggers that actually live in this county, and the trees they cut do not belong to people in this county or this state. Most of it is timber company that's investors from all over the world. Now, when you look at the Martins and McCormicks and some of those, you don't find the roads tore up like you do these out-of-town haulers. Those guys live here and they want to take care of the stuff. Like, they don't try to cheat us and go around the roads that we don't want them on. It's the outer county and even maybe out of state. And then when you look at the revenue, the trees, you know, I want to make sure that a man, say Daniel owns 100 acres of trees and he grew them, that's a farm just like a cotton or soybean, he should be able to get his trees out of there, and I want to support him and give him an avenue. And then when one of these local guys cut the trees or haul them, we don't have a problem with that type of stuff. It's whenever these big land companies that have no interest here in Mississippi or Rankin County, and so the loggers also, we don't get one penny of revenue. And that's what bothers me, is they're the ones that tear our roads up, and boy, they're just waving at us as they go. That's the ones, and I hate to say, I don't include all loggers when I say that, because we do have some Rankin County loggers that take care of our properties like they're supposed to be. And I don't want to throw at dirt haulers when everything they're doing is revenue back to the county.
Sure.
So that was why I'm saying, if we're going to do it to the dirt haulers, we dang sure need to do it to these outlaw log haulers.
Well, Steve, he was really talking about developer, but we can also do dirt deals.
We're talking about that.
But how are we
going
to get, money from them? If we just do a bond and they don't tear a road, we're not going to get anything.
Right.
But what you're going to say is we want to benefit from dirt.
Let me ask
from
you
the
this.
Trees.
From a logger.
Yeah.
Since you've been on this board, how many times do you recall collecting $1 to fix a road after they torn it up?
None. Well, we ain't done many for dirt pits either. I think we've done one.
I'm talking about loggers, though.
Yeah.
And so there's got to be a better way. I mean, we've got to do something, because we...
What do we do on dirt pits? Do we make them put bonds up on dirt pits?
Yeah. Mike, help me out here. On a less than 4-acre pit, do we do anything with those guys? Mm. You know, they get a conditional use most of the time.
Right.
Yeah.
And part of what we have done in the past on a conditional use on the small pits, the exempt pits, the 4 acres left, is as part of conditional use, we've told them that they've got to set a route and abide by the route.
Yeah.
So hours of operation, specific route, that's sort of how we have controlled that in the past, the condition of the permit.
Yeah.
To operate the pit. Now, that's to the pit owner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You see, and so there's some holes in the way that we do that from a collateral standpoint. We need to address some sort of security. The way that we have to deal with that is from the permit holder. It'd be the same way on the logging permit.
Yeah.
And the one issue that, and really this is something me and Steve can talk about later, but the one issue that I have on the logging side is, he put his finger on something about the out-of-state, the big boards, the GPs, the IPs, those guys, and their related entities that hold title to the property. They're not just big in out-of-state, they're big and they got lobbyists. And so what I want to look at is
the
state law. Yeah, we did know.
I'm glad you support it.
I spent some time looking at state law on how
did not
how we can invoke local ordinance on them, because my concern is that there may be something in state law that limits what counties can do on loggers. Okay, so that's just
well, now, you know, we won't get into this.
Well, don't municipalities put tariffs?
Let's drag this on. We can talk about that in more detail. But
a lot of what we can't really do on them is weight limit enforcement. If they're on a state highway or a state A type road, they get very ticky about counties trying to enforce particular weight limits.
You clearly can't do it on a rural road because we don't have anything that sets the weight limit.
That goes back to this issue of, if it's a public road, then the public has access and the loggers are a part of that.
Yeah.
So there's a counterbalance that we need to look through. I want to make sure that we don't jump out and try to enforce a regulation and we're just going to get slapped on it. So I need to spend some time on that.
Yeah, okay.
this doesn't address logging, obviously, at all. But I guess you could do the same sort of thing for loggers as long as it wasn't superseded by state law.
Correct. And obviously, if they're going to remove timber as part of the development, then we will address that.
What is our current development ordinance on entrance, having one entrance or two entrances? What is our minimum or maximum number of lots before you have to have two entrances?
Well, our ordinance doesn't specifically address a number of lots, I don't believe. It just says that where feasible or possible, two entrances will be provided. And if not, then you look at other alternatives. Like in some situations, we have come in, you know, and had them put what some people call bubbles halfway up and this sort of thing. But
the proposal does address
single entrance gated communities for those, so it doesn't prohibit a gated community, is the proposal here. But it tells, it said if you're proposing a gated community, then it goes through some detail as how we're going to provide school bus, garbage truck, emergency entrance, tornado comes and tree falls across your main entrance, how are we going to get emergency service in there? That's addressed in here in some detail as to what you've got to provide, what a developer would have to provide for those situations. So it doesn't prohibit gated communities, which you might want to, but it tells you what you've got to do in more detail than your current reg does if you're going to have a gated community. Or if you're going to have one entrance, you still got to have an emergency way in and out.
Well, you do.
I don't know about currently, under this proposal, yeah, it's in more detail. Under this new one, it is more detailed as to what you would have to do to provide emergency access to that development.
There's a lot of them don't have a one-way in, especially these gated communities.
Well, if it's one-way in, then I would think probably a road twice as wide or something like that.
I can get to it if you want to get into that detail, but it does address that. There's a whole section on gated communities. And
if the single road is over 900 feet, then we start squawking pretty loud about a secondary entrance.
Okay.
If it's over 900 feet.
All right.
I have to assume that the 900-foot rule is tied, Daniel, help me out, that's somehow tied to emergency response. It's got to be.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't remember off the top of my head the footage. I don't know what the numbers are.
Is there one that says that you know of?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I don't know the distance.
Right. I've always assumed that it related to how far you drag fire hose or something.
Yes.
Something like that.
A cul-de-sac now 600 feet.
That's quite a man.
You can't have a cul-de-sac, it's over 600 feet. I think that's current and that's still in here. So if you start proposing a road over 600 feet, you can't cul-de-sac for these emergency type reasons. And so that's current, you have that now, and that's still proposing here. You can do some temporary things if you're planning phase two.
And historically, the road is going to be
extended. You can do some temporary type stuff, but not permanent.
Historically, it's 500 feet.
Okay. Is there any like distance between fire hydrants?
400 feet. 400 to 500 feet on fire hydrants.
Give them a little padding, but I mean, it's a good stuff.
Thank you, Alan.
All right, thank you. Thank you.
We accomplished nothing.
No, I don't think it was to accomplish anything.
Who took the clock, man?
You asked for a timeline on this, Mr. Slate.
Yes,
I would recommend that we hit it with earnest. Hey, gentlemen, I would recommend we hit this with earnest on January 3rd meeting, maybe a revisit, and then try to wrap it up by the end of February at the latest.
I just want to be sure, like what Jay said, though, on reaching out to the Home Builder Association.
I won't be here at 3rd.
But we'll wrap it up 15. On 3rd then.
Well, we can discuss it some more in detail.
We need to can talk, think about it, and let's talk about it another.
And probably, Alan, if you need, you can email back to the board that brochure or whatever y'all put together for us to begin with. I think I could have it somewhere, but maybe just to put it back in a PDF format and send it to us.
Jay, it might be good then maybe give us time to think about it, whatever, maybe have him come back on the work session before.
29th, you're going to be out of town 29th, you're going to be out of town then too.
Yeah.
So I may be out of town 29th.
You'll be
here then. I can just keep
if it's moving. Thursday, I'll be here that Thursday. I'll be gone that Friday though.
Well, I mean, you'll be here for a work session?
Thursday, yeah.
Well, maybe we'll try to do that. That'll give us time to go over it and think about it and then have some questions.
We don't have a Home Builder Association to work for. Bringing in
whatever you have in there for dump trucks, put in there for loggers.
I think we need to get our minds
before we vote on something.
All right, well, what is that, Alan? Why don't you just plan on coming back from the work session whenever that is?
December
29th.
Yeah.
And then we ought to be able to get ours together, and then the 15th we'd be able to take care of it.
Yes, we mainly just wanted to start generating some thinking again on it because we sent you some stuff way back.
Yeah.
We know how that works.
In January, we have a holiday at the middle meeting, so we're going to have to decide what day we're going to take it.
Okay, well, we got time to do that.
It'll be that 13th or that 17th.
17th is a Monday.
Tuesday. That's the third Monday, which is a holiday.
Okay.
And so we'll look at the 13th according to what Laura wants to do. And
we got time.
So.
We got time. You can think about it over Christmas.
The next item under my section, if we're ready to move, is the I refer to this as the Florence Medical Clinic. This is a building that back in the early 90s was the title was transferred from an individual to the Board of Trustees of the Rankin Medical Center. The deed granting title to the property into the trustees of the medical center has what's called a reverter clause. That clause says if at any time the property is no longer being used as a medical clinic, it's undefined other than just use, if it's no longer serving the function of providing medical clinic services, title automatically reverts back to the grantor. So that building has not served as a medical clinic for years. Jared, help me. A number of years, maybe 6 or 7 years, I guess. That was the latest information I got.
At least 6 or 7.
Yes. And so the successors in interest to the grantor who has passed away, the successors in interest triggered the reverter. They put the county on notice. It's not functioning as a medical clinic. Title revests. We want a quitclaim deed from the county. The deed into the Board of Trustees of the Medical Center also had language that says if at some point it's not serving as a medical clinic, then the Board of Trustees of Rankin Medical Center are entitled to receive the fair value of the improvements on the property. Mm-hmm. So that is the exchange for the reverter. And so based on the request from the successors in interest to the original grantor to the county, and by the way, the county now assumed title and responsibility because we are the successor to the Board of Trustees of Rankin Medical Center. Because that came to us, we had to go through the process of figuring out, all right, what is the fair value of the improvements? We had an appraisal conducted with your authority. That appraisal came back at $115,500. We gave that information to the successor in interest to the original grantor, told them this is what we believe the fair value is. And by the way, the deed doesn't say how you determine fair value. Obviously, an appraisal is the best way to do that. But it doesn't give you any instructions about how you deal with that. They've come back and said, we believe the fair value, when you consider everything, the limitations on the number of parking spaces that are available that don't comply with the City of Florence ordinance on parking, when you consider the what they are referring to as the dilapidated condition of the facility, the functional obsolescence of the facility, in other words, it doesn't really have any value for the purposes of a medical clinic because the stuff in it doesn't work for modern medical practice. That's the argument. They came back and said, we think it's worth $50,000. So y'all are at $115,500, we're at $50,000. Through a process of continued discussions about where we are on this and what ultimately will happen if we can't get together, they've come back with an offer that is 90% of the appraised value, $103,500. They're at 90% of appraised value. We don't have any other direction on this. I feel good about a 90% figure, and I think we're there, but you guys have got to give the authority to move forward. Here's what you'll need to do. I've got a board order that is prepared if y'all want to move forward today on this. If
we're not doing
we can
today.
Talk about it on Monday.
Why?
Yeah, I don't want to do it today.
All right, we'll talk about it on Monday.
All right. Yeah.
All
right. Okay. Yeah. I realized something that might need to be covered before we do this.
All right, so we'll move this on to Monday, but you got your information.
That 90 number sounded pretty good.
No, but anyway.
All right.
I'll explain. I don't want to do it right now.
Okay. All right.
So we'll move this item to Monday's agenda.
Monday's
okay.
Fine.
All right. So you've got that information.
Mm-hmm. We can do it Monday.
Voting machines. You know, we had our one of the bidders had hired one of our law firms locally to contest the numbers, and our consultant, has she come back with what we need?
Yes, sir. It's on for Monday, but if y'all are okay, we can address that quickly. I think we can address it quickly, but I'm prepared to move forward. I don't have the actual document in my hand. but it has been emailed to me. I just don't have a printed copy to share with you. But the consultant went back and looked at the arguments that were made. This is ES&S.
Yeah.
And they came before you the last board meeting and gave a presentation that basically set out their arguments about some, in their opinion, some errors that were made in the cost calculation. Our consultant went back and looked at everything, has basically given them the benefit of the doubt of a couple of things. She acknowledged that she did miss one aspect of their discount, but it did not change the end result. The end result is that ES&S's cost proposal is still results as the second low, and she has provided the analysis that establishes exactly how she got there. They are, admittedly, they're much closer than they were originally, and so their cost score increased. And so their proposal is much closer to the HART proposal. But even with the benefit of the doubt under the reanalysis, ES&S still finishes in second position, quite honestly, by a fairly significant margin.
Okay.
Greg,
so
isn't it pretty clear that that's just one aspect that we look at?
Excellent point, Steve.
I would sure like to just write them and tell them that service is probably the biggest, and we've had a long term experience with their service.
Yeah, that's right.
So they fall down to number six out of five.
Yeah. That's a nice way of putting it.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Fifth in a four-horse race. Yep. All
right. But you gave us also that quote from HART. You know,
that's correct. I'm prepared to move forward on that. If y'all, it's already on the agenda for Monday. Would you want to? Since it's on the agenda for Monday, what my plan was, Jay, was to get Janice the actual document so it could serve as backup and let you guys acknowledge receipt of the revised cost summary for ES&S. Do that on Monday and have it clearly in the records. And then also at that time, you will authorize the distribution of that revised cost summary.
Well, the reason why I won't bring it up today is because we probably need to make a change to that. If currently the way we have it is, the election commissioners only had one poll book, electronic poll book, per precinct. And I talked with the Democratic chair yesterday, and there's no way that's going to fly.
No.
So,
Jay, I'm sorry. We're talking about two different things. My bad. But what I'm saying about talking about on Monday will be the ES&S part of this.
Okay.
You okay with that?
Yeah.
All right, so now we're moving to the HART proposal, and that's what you just heard. Their poll book proposal is for 75 poll books. We've got 50 precincts. If you do the math, each party getting a poll book, 50 times 2,
it's
100.
Yeah, I can do that one.
You follow that?
Why 75? Why'd they say 75 if we was only going to do one?
It's nothing more, literally nothing more than an analysis of precinct load. The intent of the election commissioners was one poll book for each precinct. That was the initial starting point.
Yeah.
The HART representative said, you're going to have some crush times. Yep. See it in every precinct. Early,
right
out of the box, 5 o'clock when folks are getting off work. Right. Those load times will put your one poll book in a precarious situation.
Yep.
So there was no attention given to party issues. They were solely focused on one poll book per precinct. The HART guy said you really need to look and study your precinct loads and decide which of your 50 should have two poll books. But that was not for per party, Jay.
Okay.
That was just, so we got some bigger precincts.
If we knowingly we're going to have to buy at least two now, are we still going to need to buy additionals in for the load?
Yeah, yeah, because you 90% of the precincts in Rankin County.
So basically,
overheat one on the left side and one on the right side, or switch them.
Right.
Is going to have very, very few.
But so, are you saying then we probably just need to add 50 to the 75?
Well, what I would suggest is in the first round, if HART would do this, let us take our biggest precincts and staff those with the poll books for a year and see how it works. And then, if that, because the rural areas,
we really don't have to or don't need electronic poll books, and I think it would be a lot better transition if you did it in the urban areas first, and if it worked out, and after we got the kinks out of it, then order if we thought we needed more. I mean, which we would need more if we wanted to go ahead with them, but that would be my suggestion.
Yeah, because I can think of some of the small boxes that have 350, 400 people. That's what they have. They don't need all that.
Right.
I guess to Jay's
point. We're going to have to have two.
Right. Yeah, yeah. And even still, that second one is sometimes in between.
But I don't think it'll be realistic for us to use some electronic poll books and some paper poll books. That ain't jive, man.
Every rural precinct is going to have Wi-Fi or internet.
Well, we don't have to do that right now.
Well, then what can you not do with a paper book than the electronic book if it's not hooked up to Wi-Fi?
There's nothing in terms of making the election work. We can do both. Yeah, but what I'm talking about is whenever the election commissioners have to go out here and train all these people, they are needing to train everybody uniform.
But you all train them all with electronic, but some of them still might have to use regular. I don't know if all of them have Wi-Fi capability.
I'm going to tell you, selling these because when I went to the polls just this week, every one of the rural ones were saying, we don't want them tablets. We don't want those things. Well, if you're using them in the county and they see it's working and it's a growing process, you come back in a year, 18 months, and implement them out in the rural area. I mean, if you're using them in the urban areas, they'd be more apt to and probably be able to work with them better. Put five at Pisco.
Well, I'm just saying, man, if we're going to do it, we got a great price now, and we come back later.
You don't think we could work something with them to where we could grow in a year? I mean, if we had a year, 18 months to fill all of them?
The way that we're purchasing these tablets is through the company No Ink, and it's a bundle package. If we later on we want to come back and buy them, then we got to buy them through a distributor here in Mississippi.
Yeah.
What's the difference in the price?
I don't know. We're paying $1,300 now.
Your tablet price under this proposal is $375. Your tablet price, Steve.
You add in the software and everything,
that's
$1,300
per
tablet.
That's right.
That's a hidden cost.
Well, that's what we're paying, $1,300 per tablet. So we add 50 to that, that's going to be $60,000 additional to what our quote is.
But I guess though, I do look at that.
If you're going to have two in every precinct, that's already 100, and then you got half the precincts, you're going to have at least three.
Right. That's what I said. We've already got 75. Add 50 to that. So 50 more would be 60 something thousand, right?
Is two enough for I guess two would be enough for a 4,000-6,000 populated.
You already got it broken up, AGL, M3Z anyway, and that seems to have sufficed. So if you just substitute each board for those.
That's the election commissioners had already said 75 whenever they were thinking that we were going to share Democrats and Republicans.
That's right.
And so they had already ordered more than 50, you know, so they had already ordered additional for those precincts that are going to have
heavy load. The 75 plus another 50.
We should be good. If we do that, that'll be enough for the Democrats and the heavy use areas.
If you have a precinct where there's very light voting from the Democrat side and heavier, much heavier for Republican, could you use that one as a secondary if you have the line starts getting long?
Yeah, so they're all going to have the same information.
That's correct. I know, I'm sure I'm thinking like Pilahatchee may vote 800 people, and they won't have 150 probably that vote Democrat.
Yeah.
Could you, if the line got long?
We could use the tablet's a tablet. Okay. It's going to all have the same information on it.
I was asking.
But the problem is,
it's the egos and the pride and stuff.
Yep.
The Democrats want just everything that Republicans have.
That's it.
They
could claim it. That's going to be up to
the poll workers. Talk to the Democratic chair. Let him work it out.
I'm just saying, it's going to be, even though it's capable, it'll be up to those poll workers how they won't feel willing to work with each other.
All right.
Well, if we just got the 50 more, that pretty much would solve everything. We already got 75.
75, yeah.
That double up where it needed.
Okay.
And, but you could double up if you just ran into one of those situations with the two books.
If we vote on this Monday, we need to have that number updated. But also, we probably, if there's a possibility that some of our election commissioners would like to close some precincts, or if y'all wanted to close some, now would be the time to do it before we go ordering all this equipment.
Well, something that's been raised with me, and it's not closing, but at some time back, and I think it was probably back when they busted up my district in Daniels and took what's north of 25 and put in Daniels, the people out there, they say they've got at least 100 people they can bring in here, put on them. And I'm just saying, just hold on, let me talk with the guys. The people that live north of 25 from the county line at Scott County down to Fannin, who used to vote at Pisgah, mm-hmm. could walk in and vote and get out. Now, Fannin has gotten it's grown so much, and they put them in Fannin, mm-hmm. and they live, some of them, 1 mile from, I say 1 mile, right. 2 miles from the voting precinct at Pisgah, but they're driving 5-6 miles, say 5 miles mm-hmm. down to Fannin and standing in a long line. What do I have to do or to initiate getting just the north side of 25 back into the Pisgah precinct where there's...
Is it all District 4?
No, they split my district. They split us and put just a sliver of my, what used to be...
I remember Wood went up and caught that tail up there.
It's a narrow, long, narrow...
When you got part of, took in that, he had to go up, take a tail right through there, up north.
Is that...
Where we get into precinct splits, that's one of the reasons
why. And it makes it really difficult because that Pisgah gets split and some other. Anyhow, go ahead.
Yeah, that would be the consideration that would justify a little bit more inconvenience for those folks to actually vote in a precinct where it wouldn't generate a precinct split like that. So that's the purpose behind it.
You got the exact same thing on
Well, Craig, how can we fix that?
Monterey Road.
Oh, it's real simple.
Monterey, vote for Briar Hill.
We get with the election commissioner.
Briar Hill, one side vote.
And we get them to look at the precinct, the layout of the precinct, look at the load.
It's way heavy. Yeah. And Pisgah, now, they'll have about 200 turnouts.
Fortunately, we got our planners here with us, so it's really simple. Redraw that precinct boundary.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Yep. And
see y'all next meeting.
But what we got to look at, Steve, we got to make sure that we don't implicate our numerically.
Yeah, won't that change? That's going to change your numbers, though.
But we're not going to get into supervisory district change or anything like that. We're just changing precinct boundaries. Yeah. But we want to look at it and make sure that we can draw those accurately and adequately. We follow certain principles.
I think if we look at the way it was before it was redrawn, that would be a good go by.
Won't that put them back in your district?
Yeah, no. Well, yeah. Just the precinct, not the voting, not the line. And
yeah, I'm sure
in 2020, whenever we relook at these maps, he's going to have to lose some ground because he's population, so I'll probably get that anyhow.
Hey, Steve, if we can,
I will.
They've got their information here.
You can just hold
right
two
after
signs,
the meeting. Dave has got, they've got the map right here. So they'll put the polling precinct layers up here, and then after our meeting,
right.
We can look at it and see how we might could lay it out.
Yeah, you got it right here in your computer on our website.
Okay.
That's the central plan development.
All right. Anything else on that?
So
on this, on what were we on?
Yeah,
we moved on to that. Okay,
we're on the part deal. Yeah. So we're gonna go back and ask them to price 125 tablets, right?
Yes.
Okay.
50 more. Yeah.
Let me ask you guys to help me with this for the purpose of getting a final number. What I need to know is, are we interested in the extended warranty on the equipment? I told you what the pricing on that was. It's per year, $9,075 per year for years 2, 3, 4, and 5. That's a steady price, pay the same thing every time for the extended warranty. I sent you a follow-up email that laid out for you in basic language what the extended warranty gets you. So y'all need to tell me whether or not we're going for the extended warranty.
I think it's a waste of money, because I think the reason why they came to us without a hardware warranty maintenance is because anything that can be replaced, which is going to be the batteries, we can do that, is either going to be cleaning a screen, you know, or replacing a drum, ink. That's all things that we can do ourselves. And if there's any hardware malfunction, it's disposable. There's no repairing this stuff anymore. You throw in the garbage, buy another one.
When they were doing their presentation, they pretty much spelled that out to us, that you won't, the parts that would be covered are not really going to break down very often, and if they do, it's just, I didn't think it was something.
They price it as an option for a reason.
It's kind of like the extended warranty on a TV. I would never do that.
Yeah.
And exactly. You can't repair a TV these days, you know? Those tablets, you know, the good thing about the company we're working with too is we'll obviously pay the software maintenance on it, but every time Apple comes up with a new iPad and a new OS to go onto it, we automatically get all ours updated. So, you know, and if one of those iPads break, we just go buy another $400 iPad.
Yeah.
You know, so.
I don't know about it.
Okay.
I'm not real big on those.
If y'all are comfortable, then we will exclude the extended warranty discussion. We'll ask them to price the 125 tablets and come back to you on Monday with an actual contract. It's got a figure in it that I can give to you.
Okay.
And go from there.
One thing? Check with the election commissioners and see if they're comfortable with that number, if we're having to double up with the Democrats.
We'll do that. I sent them an invitation to come today. So,
okay.
Well, I talked to them yesterday.
They said that work. Yeah. That would work.
Yeah. And also, I noticed that I fully expected for us to be having more than one scanner at each precinct or some precincts, and we don't. And they were okay with that. They met with the vendor, and the vendor, they all agreed that we're going to go with one per precinct. I fully expected to be buying multiple at some, but
they told us how many you could run ballots. I mean, how many they would really work in a day. And I think about 3,000.
The number that they use is 4,000. 4,000. So if your precincts are under four, they recommend one.
I was surprised. So that's why I called Tanya Rivers and said, make sure that I was reading this correct, that we're only buying this many. And she said, no, after talking with the vendor, they said they'd be glad to sell us more. You was in that meeting, wasn't you?
Yes, sir.
Well, why don't you tell them then?
What Jay just told you is exactly what the election commission decided. They were very clear that they were. Ms. Laura, remind me. I put them on the spot in that meeting. I said, now, guys, are y'all comfortable recommending to the board one scanner per precinct? Are you comfortable with that? And they all said yes.
That meeting recorded.
I'm not election commissioner, but I think if you've got a precinct that requires two tablets, then you probably need two scanners, because it's going to take same amount of time for somebody on a tablet.
Well, the good news is, though, we're buying 10 extra, so we'll.
All right. But I mean, it just don't make sense to have two tablets and one scanner.
Quickly, Steve, just to allay that concern, we raised that issue. One of the election commissioners said, what do we do about a voter who is like a calf staring at a new gate when they get to the scanner?
Yep.
They freeze and they don't know what to do. What do we do in that point? And they were satisfied with the vendor's response on how that's handled. The vendor was very clear. Where the backups occur for the scanner are not at the scanner. They are at the individual tables or stalls where the actual voting, the marking of the ballot. They said, make sure you've got plenty of areas for people to go take care of their ballot marking.
Yep.
Because that's where the backup will be. They weren't concerned at all about the scanner. They were concerned about the place where the
What are we going to do about that? Is that part of this price?
No, sir.
The little boots?
Yeah, what are we going to do about that?
Each one of them had a little thing they showed us.
The election commissioners are already working on their partitions. That's already a part of the process, and they're looking at their precinct locations to make sure that they have tables and chairs to provide that place. They're looking, they're evaluating all of that. That's part of the election commissioner's responsibility.
All right. Okay.
So, before Monday, though, I know that some election commissioners would like to maybe do away with some. So, y'all might want to talk to your election commissioner and see if y'all want to do that before Monday.
If they want to do it, that's their cup of tea.
Well, actually, it's ours.
Between the election commissioners.
Yep. Yeah, the number of precincts is you guys. The locations are you guys. That's you guys.
I don't see where I have one that I could. What bigger geographic areas I cover?
I don't have one.
I think wisely, the board members have never intruded. They've always worked through the election commissioners to make those determinations.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, look at Jay. Well, you just know better.
That was a good one.
Jay knows better.
Talk to him and see.
He knows better.
Yeah, they probably could have one precinct in Pearl.
All right. Anything else from Craig? Okay. Well, on election commission. Well, I might ask that later. Never mind, it's nothing. Laura, Ms. Oster, our county administrator.
Thank you. First thing I have is authority to pay David Morrow Jr. for Family Master Services for the month of October and authority to issue that check in the amount of $2,500.
I'll make a motion.
Second.
Motion approved, Mr. Gaines. Second, Mr. Bishop. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
Hey, Laura, can we not just go ahead and put that for the whole
come
year?
On in. Bob. Okay.
I don't know when we look at it. I know that the order that we have currently runs only through December, and then there'll be another one issued, and when it is, we'll look at that differently, maybe.
We'll ask them to restructure their order.
That way we don't have to do this every meeting.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Next item I have is authority to purchase two 2012 used Chevrolet Tahoes and one 2013 Tahoe from the Missouri Highway Patrol. In the amount of $50,500 each, and authority for deputies Dan McClendon, Billy Lord, Brian Whittington, and Steve Weaver to travel to Missouri and pick up the vehicles and pay any travel-related expenses.
So moved.
Second. Motion approved, Mr. Morrow. Second, Mr. Gaines.
Ken, can I ask you a question on that?
Discussion.
Would it be?
He's part-time, sir.
Well, right now, I think he's full-time right now. At this time, you are on the pay, aren't you?
You're on the hook for this answer, so go ahead.
We got a little extra time with Ken. We've got some play there.
Okay.
He owes us a little bit of time, I think, somewhere down the line.
I understand sending four people because you got to come back in four vehicles. But if two of them flew up there, and would that be more expensive than to have hotels and M&IE and travel than for two guys to fly and come back in the vehicles and four to travel up there and back?
It'd be way cheaper to drive up there.
Okay. I did that for Indiana, and it was cheaper for me to fly. But I was able to book it out, 45 days or so.
That's the problem with us. We don't know. He just called me yesterday.
Okay.
And he just got it set up. And then he's going to have probably, he said, in the next 3 weeks, and have our other three ready to go. So we drive
up. All right.
Good.
Next item is the review of the agendas for December.
Wait, we had a motion and a second. And discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
All right. Now we have the review of the agendas. I do know that we will have a few things added on to the agenda for Monday that came in late. We will have two personnel requisitions that will be in there, and also I will have one added on to the consent for a $1,000 deductible that we need to pay for some equipment that was damaged. The company has paid Lyle Machinery, but we'll have to pay the deductible. So we will have a couple of add-ons.
Okay.
I want to have a discussion about our road crew, our manager maybe moving some offices around and getting our whole road department down at the road building rather than split half and half up here. But even if we don't do that, we need to address getting internet to our safe room and better quality to our barn, road barn.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked Rusty to kind of give us an update on what we're looking at, what our options are.
Mike, do you want to have anything to add? I know that we talked briefly last week, kind of our options and where we're at is the barn. The cabling in the barn is a mess. So the internet that they've got in there is about the best we can give them without spending a fortune trying to fix it all. And partially is because over the years people have removed things, pulled things, cut things. We don't know what's what. I mean, it looks like rats have been living in the wiring. Okay. Probably. One thing we talked about was Mike trying to consolidate his offices, especially in a storm, so that he's got one place to command everything and he's not trying to run up here, answer the phone, or come up here and get something and go back there. Da, da, da. We've got a couple options. We could run fiber from one of those buildings that's on Marquette to there. That would connect them to the county network. The downside to that is it's expensive. Price, don't know. I'm estimating it's a long run, so it's going to be expensive, $12,000 approximately.
But that would be something though that we would own, right?
Correct. We wouldn't pay a service on it.
Yeah. Right.
The other options are involve AT&T or involve Comcast or one of those service providers to try to bring in a connection into one of those locations. But that would cost about $100 a month, approximately. So, you know, you'd end up, you know, meeting yourself after, you know, a couple of years. So,
what do we have at the storm building now?
Right now, the employee that's there just has a Verizon connection, hotspot.
Oh, really? So we just wireless, I mean,
that's
internet.
That's correct.
Mobile.
That's correct. Mm-hmm.
So how can we have fiber to our EOC, obviously.
That's correct.
Could we take it from EOC and then go from there to the other two buildings?
My thought was we can run fiber from EOC to the FEMA safe building and then make just a hop that county employees can do from the FEMA building over to the multipurpose pavilion. But the barn, you're going to have a hard time getting to. Because with Marquette being on the other side of the road, the best place to run it from would be the warehouse. So you're looking at an equal length of run, unless you want to aerial it over the road. In other words, Marquette's here, FEMA building's here, multipurpose pavilion's here, warehouse is here, and barn is over here. If you run fiber from Marquette or from EOC down, you're either going to have to hop the road and come all the way down to the barn in addition to the FEMA building,
right?
Or move him into the FEMA building or somewhere close by and just run the fiber just to there.
I don't want to get in, I don't know a whole lot about what I'm saying, but I would think that your office over at somewhere in that multi-purpose building or safe room or whatever, would you have a problem with that?
No, somewhere's close right down there where I'm right there.
And had you rather be at the old barn or up on the hill at the new facility? I mean,
it don't matter to me, Steve. All it.
Well, what I'm
thinking more logical would be down at the barn.
I know,
I think so too. If you don't make the move,
well, we can't put anything in that.
You can't put them in the FEMA safe room.
Huh?
Can't put anything in the safe room.
Can't put him in the safe room.
That's a big area around there. We do have an office there right now that Trish uses at times. But anyhow, if y'all think that, I mean, we're not ever going to move out of that barn. Because I'd hate to spend the money to update and get all that done, and then we say, well, it's 2 years later, we're going to move out there again.
It won't be in 2 years.
It won't be in 2 years.
I don't think we will, because it's of the nature of the beast it is, you know, the material it's made of. We won't be tearing it down.
We're married to that.
Yes, pretty much.
So what do we suggest? Where are we suggesting putting your office?
I've looked at either down there inside that shop down there, or either.
What about one of these cottages?
Yeah.
That if we could take one of those cottages and build an office out of it, could you let us do that, Under Sheriff?
And I don't think we're talking about having to make the move today either.
We're just trying to spark the conversation
later on next year.
If we could get his office made nice, not what it currently is.
Do what?
Where his office is now.
Yeah.
Go in there and basically rebuild it and put in a nice facility, office facility.
I kind of like you being at the headquarters where it is, if you're going to do that. I mean, looks
might as well. I mean,
well, that's where the men are.
Huh?
That's where the men are.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think that's better.
The problem is.
We could put one of them cottages up there right by the storm building. You know?
Yeah, we put one right there by the storm building.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
Y'all march on them out by yourself.
I already told them that one was in a go.
All right, well,
anyway, who can we get?
All right, well, let's give us some thought then on where you.
Yeah, I mean,
Jimmy Kurtz,
what you
gonna do? Fastest person.
I got a couple thoughts.
The biggest thing is getting the internet service there, but I mean,
as close as a ballpark.
We're gonna be there a while. 12,000 is really not.
Well,
if we're gonna be there a while, Comcast, we could get a business connection out there for $100 a month. Yeah. Well, I would get a firewall and encrypt the connection back. See what I'm saying? So they would be kind of like they are on DSL now. That's what I've got. I've got a firewall.
When we're talking about moving the office, are we talking about Lynn going out there also?
I think that's what he might say.
Extra piece.
So we'd need more than one office.
We'd have to go and build a nice office area.
Well, if we're talking about spend that, $12,000 is not going to.
No, probably more like 50.
What?
50?
It'd be more than that.
I'm talking about inside the shell going in.
Why don't you come up with some ideas and come back to us with it that suit what you think would suit you?
Yeah.
But I know,
the internet side.
I think the board is set on him being at that facility, so Rusty can move on, give him marching orders to do what we need to do to get the service to him.
Yeah, I can get a couple options together.
Okay, go and do that, because I think let him and Mike decide how he's going to do it, but it's still going to be there.
Yeah, well, we need something better at our storm shelter too, because we do have people that use it and need.
I understand.
Yeah, I mean, we go and you may as well get to
that. But I don't know. We already got the shop taken care of, don't we? They already have.
Yes. Yes. The shop has a fiber run to ESC.
Oh. Well, can we run from the shop over there then?
Yes. Yes. What I was saying earlier was you can go from the shop down to the barn, but if you want the FEMA building too, you might as well just go from EOC down to the FEMA room instead of trying to make a whole bunch of hops around the road.
Yeah. So we could just do from the shop to the barn and then from EOC to the FEMA building.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
All right, you'll check with somebody. Okay.
We'll have one upfront cost and that's it.
All right. Got that. We got some additional business to be discussed here.
We do, and while Rusty's in here before he leaves, I'm going to let him go ahead and talk about the MiFi card for Judge Shirley.
No. No.
Do you even know what
just
it's about?
Say, I have no clue what MiFi card is. Is it Judge Shirley?
What is a MiFi card?
That's the ceasefire hotspot connection. Judge Shirley has a high requirement for internet connection when he's in the old courthouse. And about once or twice a month when he comes in. He has serious issues, and it ends up tying way more than $40 a month off of our time trying to get him all situated.
Wait a minute now. We have network through that building, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Why can't he use...
Because he's using an iPad.
Because he's using an iPad.
Sir.
Well, why don't he just use a Windows-based tablet and...
We can make Russ that recommendation.
It's not his place to say that.
Huh? I'm just trying to fulfill his... trying to fulfill his requirements.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's Mr. Slay's obligation.
What are we talking about here?
We're talking about a $40 a month hotspot.
For a building that we have networked.
Yeah.
$40 a month.
That's just like us paying $40 a month for you to go in your office so you can use your iPad.
I'm not in there as much as he is.
He could use a cell phone hotspot if he has a personal cell phone.
That's what that is.
I know, but if he...
He's paying for his
personal. Yeah.
He's paying for his personal. He don't want to use his data. Just let us pay his data.
But he could look him to wire.
And there's two of them on here for him? No. Oh.
No.
No, okay.
No, it's just the Wi-Fi card.
I got you.
We're building a new building.
You're going to have the same problems. The problem is this the connectivity of this iPad.
Let's just say no. Let's make a motion to say no. We're on record. What the heck, you know?
Yeah.
Y'all can go ahead and say no. The only thing I was asking for it for is to save us time and energy.
But, Rusty, if we do this for him, we need to be doing it for everybody else.
I know. I understand.
Everybody else where?
I understand.
All the judges.
All of us same problem?
Anybody comes with that request.
You could have that complaint here.
Yeah.
Mike has, they have two MiFi cards that he said they don't work.
Yeah, have one of mine.
He said they don't work.
Yours don't work? We'll give him that one.
That's all I'm saying. Work in him.
But when they get out, he said they don't work.
You ain't got service on the cell phone. I mean, service goes down on the cell phone, they don't work anyway.
Well, that's right. Yeah. But he'll have service over here. Do you not use yours? Seriously?
You get out in the countryside, when you get below 3 G's, they won't work. Or mine don't.
I'm not wanting to add one. So if there's one around, somebody wants to donate to him, I'm fine with. But other than that, no.
Okay.
Mike's gonna need his.
Yeah.
Next. Do we need to vote on that?
No.
It said to be discussed.
It was just discussion. Yeah. If y'all aren't bored, it's on the record. We'll go with it. The next item is the discussion of donation of Wi-Fi equipment to be placed on the county inventory. Rusty has three Wi-Fi connections from his own house that he's not using. He changed his service back in 2013. He donated some equipment. We accepted it, put it on the county inventory, and wrote a little letter giving it to him for tax credit. This is three of them, at $50 a piece?
Correct.
So $150. Correct. And he plans to use them at youth court.
Sure.
Okay.
I make a motion. Will you accept that?
Okay. Thank you.
Second.
Motion, Mr. Gaines. Second, Mr. Bishop.
Go ahead. Discussion. Need to add it, or can we just vote on it?
No, okay. It's on there.
All favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, and I believe we have
We do have an executive session personnel.
Right. And I'd like everybody to leave the room but us and Mr. Slay and Ms. Osmond.
Oh, okay.
Jessica gets to stay, I guess.
What
would y'all
make a
motion?
How you doing, man? Yeah.
What's that?
I made the motion in the game
for second. Discuss the need to go in there.
Haven't done that. Nobody made any kind of motion.
That's what Jamie said.
Over that, they're hauling over that retirement village or home or something. Sister Lily's here. Must be a big job. I went over and welded a pan scraper the other day. I knew exactly where he started telling me. I knew exactly where he was. He's like, "How'd you know where I was?" I said, "Oh, right there." Yeah, and it's not bothering me a bit. It's just everybody seems, like I told you, I can care less, but I know that's what they're doing. And they're hitting that road, and it's not bothering anybody else. It's just everybody else is seeing it. And then I feel like, and that's what Kelly's going to come up and say, when he's just not.
Yeah.
That's where he needs to go. He kept saying, "I got a place to go right now." But, I mean,
Hey, don't even get him in here.
Needs to tell me that's where he wants him to haul me there.
Oh, it's a joke, too. We're going to take it as a joke.
Okay.
We're going to consider it that way.
I make a motion to discuss the need to go into executive session for personnel.
Second. Motion by Mr. Bishop. Need to go to executive session. Second. Mr. Morrow. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
Yes.
Right, Janice, I'm going to need Janice.
I have three executive personnel.
I need everybody but just us.
Yeah. I'm going to get the motions and cut off.
Okay.
I make a motion going to executive session.
Second.
All right. Motion by Mr. Bishop going to executive session. Second, Mr. Gaines. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Okay.
What might we think?